And so we know, based on WINGS data, that perhaps several thousand people got lung cancer. That's what he looked at. Additions to the lung cancer population, because that data was available. All the other data is lacking. The industry convinced Judge Rambo to do a really poor analysis, and as a result, all of the data that that came out of that accident is essentially useless, and deliberately so, because the NRC and the nuclear industry definitely wanted to downplay the significance. So Wing did the best job possible with the information available, and he shows that there really were significant increases in cancer after the accident.
Can the release of radioactive isotopes affect the ionization of the upper levels of the atmosphere?
You know, I found a scientific paper that says it can. I don't know personally, but there is a paper out there that's about 30 years old that talks about releases of radioactive material into the upper atmosphere affecting the ions that are up there. Someone thought to study it 30 years ago, and there's, as far as I know, just one paper that supports that. But there's no papers that refute it.
And recently, TEPCO has released a bunch of their recordings of a video conference, son audio. What's your opinion on these video conference releases?
I watched them, and I was appalled. The Japanese are supposed to be the best people on the planet for emergency organization. You know, as a culture, they're organized, and as a culture, they know that earthquakes occur. So they should have ingrained in them the best you'd expect people to behave in the event of of an accident. And frankly, I saw the worst. The people at the Tokyo Electric Home Office had no clue what the plant people were experiencing. And frankly, I think the plant people were at their best when they were on their own. There are heroes here, and there's 1,000 men at Fukushima Daiichi, and there's another 1,000 people at Fukushima Daini who risked their lives and did extraordinary things with very minimal supplies to wrestle this bowl to the ground, but they didn't get any help from Tokyo Electric offsite people, and they didn't get any help from the government. They did it despite Tokyo Electric and despite the government. And, as a former operator, I have the deepest respect for those couple of thousand people who stayed behind and saved the country.
And they've had many successes. I mean, the demolitions, and they've been working really hard. They've been doing pretty good considering the hand they've been dealt and the lack of support.
There could have been 14 meltdowns and not three. If you look at the data, there's 6 units at Fukushima Daiichi. There's 4 units at Fukushima Daini. There's another 3 down at Onagawa. And there's another Tokai. The net effect there is that there's 37 diesel generators between those plants. 24 of those diesels were knocked out by the tsunami. So we, as an engineering culture, you need the diesels to cool the plant. And, of course, we all know at Fukushima Daiichi, the diesels were flooded. But at the other plants, the diesels weren't flooded. They were knocked out because the tsunami knocked out the cooling water to the diesel, something we call service water. And so Japan narrowly missed 14 meltdowns and not 3 because the cooling water to 24 of the 37 diesels was destroyed. And again, brave men at Onagawa and Tokai essentially stepped into the breach too, and prevented this accident from becoming more severe too. The plant manager at Fukushima Daini, which is the, not Daiichi, which is the one that had the accident, but Daini, which is 6 miles away, he's quoted as saying that if the tidal wave happened on a Saturday, his four units would have melted down too. He had 1,000 people on site because it was a Friday. If it happened on a weekend, there would have been a skeleton crew there. The roads would have been destroyed, so nobody could have got in to help. And we would have had Fukushima Daiichi and Fukushima Daini in meltdown condition. So we came very close to what happened was unimaginable. This is almost unimaginable how close we came to losing 14 nuclear reactors.
Insane.
Well, you'll have to excuse me. I, as always, when I speak with you, my mind gets racing and I lose my train of thought. We were speaking about the cultural aspects of Japanese society. What do you think about all of the popular protests and the videos that were coming out from the politicians and the mayors of towns and all that?
What we're seeing is a dramatic change in the Japanese culture as a result of the accident. And it's being spearheaded by women. There's a lot of men who say, well, you know, my government right or wrong. But the women are saying, you know, the heck with you, I'm taking the kids and getting out of here. So this protest movement is unique in Japan for two reasons. One is they normally don't protest. You know, there's a hierarchical structure where they really seem to want to believe what their government says. But so that whole concept of protesting on the order of 200,000 people very, very rarely happens in Japan, and here it's happening week after week. The other piece of that is that it's being spearheaded by women. You know, this is a patriarchal society, so to see women take the lead on this matter is a really significant cultural change. I'm going to be in Tokyo and in Japan, not just Tokyo, but in some of the surrounding areas for 2 weeks. And the organizations that are putting me up in Japan are run by women. So this is a cultural change. I hope it continues, but it's a cultural change the likes of which the Japanese have never seen before.
And what do you think's in store for the plant in the coming year?
Well, Fukushima Daiichi 1, 2, and 3 are unimaginably contaminated. You know, I suspect they'll pick around the edges and look. But, the fact is the cores have been breached, and there's radioactive material inside the containment and outside the containment. Now, I'm not saying there's a meltdown. What I'm saying is that because the containment leaks, the water's in contact with the fuel is tiny, tiny particles, and now nuclear fuel has been lifted out of the containment through holes and leaks in piping runs and in penetrations, electrical penetrations, and is now in other buildings. The concentration of radioactivity in something called the torus room, which is not part of the containment, it's outside the containment, is so high it tells me that radioactive dust has settled on the floor of this building and is now flooded under 5, 6, 7 feet of water. But there's no technology to clean that up. It's got to be, and yet to wait is 300 years. I don't know, you know, perhaps not in my lifetime, but somebody will come up with a robot to go in and clean it up. But another possibility is that they could just pour concrete over some of these highly contaminated areas and wait 300 years and come back. Now, I did this for a living, and I don't know how you would get near enough to these areas to do an adequate cleanup.
Didn't the U.S. military come up with a plan to entomb the reactors almost immediately after the incident, and it was never carried out?
Right. Entombing the reactors after the incident would have been really hard because there's an enormous amount of decay heat left over. And the heat had to be, you had to cool the reactors down. But, you know, we're a year and a half out, and perhaps in the next 2 or 3 years, there will be less heat to the point where you could entomb the reactors. So I was never a fan of entombing the reactors at the beginning because that would create a meltdown because there's no place for the water to take the heat and the cores would have melted. So entombment early on I don't think was a good idea. But at this point, my mind is changing, and I think perhaps on units 1, 2, 3, and 4, the best thing to do is to keep them cool for a couple more years and then entomb them for 300 and come back. Unit 4 is a different story. We've got to get the fuel out. It's up in the air. There's no containment. If there's a seismic event, it would burn in air. So that's got to be everybody's focal point right now.
Well, the mainstream media really hasn't been covering this story at all in the recent months, but it's been still covered extensively by alternative media. E&E News has been really big on that. And do you think the story's over?
I think this is still going to be a long slog. You know, I think, first off, you're going to see the cancer fatalities growing. And despite the best attempts by the Japanese government to cover this thing up, citizens are going to get the information out that there's a lot of deformities and there's a lot of cancers will be identified in the next couple of years. You know, the on-site problems are incredibly costly. If nothing else, there's the amount of money to solve that problem is daunting. The Japanese aren't facing up to that. You know, they talk about, well, this quarter we need $10 billion. This quarter we need $10 billion. And nobody's saying that, hey, we're going to be at this for 50 years. We're going to be at this for $500 trillion. They're not that. They don't want to hear that because the number is so astronomically high. I think it's frightening. But I've been saying this for a year now. To solve a big problem, you have to admit you have a big problem. And to my mind, the Japanese, because their mainstream media is not bringing it up, are unaware of the magnitude of the problem.
Unfortunately, California seems to have been having some small earthquake swarms. At least the silver lining here, have we learned some lessons from Fukushima that we can apply to safety in the future?
I don't think we've learned any of the lessons from Fukushima. The United States government, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, is applying several Band-Aid fixes. But, you know, as long as we've got 23 of these nuclear reactors identical to Fukushima operating with, the old containment vents and the NRC seems perfectly willing to look the other way and admit that these containments are the poorest design in the world. During the middle of the accident, a guy named Chuck Casso, who's now the Region 3 administrator out of Chicago, blurted out in a phone call, these are the worst containments in the world. So the NRC knows that these Mark 1 containments are the worst in the world, and they're continuing to allow them to operate. To my way of thinking, unless you face that problem, you haven't learned the lessons of Fukushima.
Okay, well, thanks so much, Arnie. I mean, what are you up to in the future? Can you tell us a little bit about what Fairwinds has got in store for us?
Well, the future is bright for Fairwinds, and I go to Tokyo for 2 weeks, the last week in August and the first week in September. I'll be speaking to Tokyo University, Kyoto University. I'll be speaking throughout the country, and I'm looking forward to that. The other thing that's keeping us really busy right now is the San Onofre problems and the fact that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission allowed this thing to be built and operated and really jeopardized all of Southern California. We've got a fundraiser underway, and if any of your listeners would like to go over to our PayPal on our site, I sure would appreciate it, because in order to do this kind of stuff, Maggie and I work for free, but it still costs money to produce these videos, and I'd appreciate some help.
Thanks. Yeah, I really would encourage everybody to go pitch in a few bucks to Arnie and pitch in a few bucks to us. You want to sponsor a podcast? That'd be great, because we can't do these podcasts without you. Thank you so much for coming on the podcast, Arnie, and I'm really looking forward to speaking with you again.
Okay, thanks for having me. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now.
Well, as usual, very informative analysis from Arnie. Next.